sampling, aliasing, the Nyquist theorem. These are all things that we've discussed here and there on this channel, but we've never once looked at, you know, this subject as a whole. What we're gonna do today is we're gonna look at sampling, we're gonna go from the ground up, and hopefully in doing so, well, all the other concepts will sort of come into place naturally, instead of, you know, being isolated videos like they used to be. So, sampling is our topic of choice today. You're watching another Random Wednesday episode on 0612 TV. Hello and welcome to another Random Wednesday episode. So, today, we're gonna take sampling from the ground up. And so let's begin by illustrating, you know, the whole idea of why we even need sampling in the first place with a very simple example. Now, take for example, I'm just sitting here and I'm talking. Basically, what I'm doing is I'm generating these little compressions and rarefactions in air that an ear will pick up as sound. So essentially, sound is just movement of air. We can actually represent this in terms of a waveform, and a waveform will look something like this. And what this is trying to show you is that at a particular point in space, this is what's happening to the air particles in the area. They're moving back and forth over time. So you can imagine the vertical axis of the waveform basically telling you, you know, how the air is moving either backwards or forwards, with respect, of course, to a zero position. And the horizontal axis of this waveform represents time. So right, let's say now I'm talking and you want to record this. You want to capture this so you can play it back at a later time. Clearly, the way in which you want to do that is to basically record the movement of air over the duration of time in which I'm talking. By being able to record this movement, you will of course be able to reproduce this movement and, in other words, reproduce the sound of my voice. In fact, this is where the story ends for analog recording devices, you know, like tapes or vinyl, because, well, they basically store exactly that, an analog representation of how the air actually moves over time. But let's say now we want to do something a little bit more complicated. We want to actually grab the sound information and store it digitally. That is, of course, on a computer or any other electronic device. Because of the way these storage devices store information, we cannot simply take a continuous piece of data, like a sound wave, and expect, you know, to save that wave verbatim. There's just no way. We have to actually discretize it first, and then save these discrete samples. And in fact, I've just actually used the word that describes the process, and that is sampling. The whole idea is this. When you have a waveform that looks like this, well, what I can do is I can say, all right, at this point of time, this is the amount of displacement, you know, in the vertical axis, and then I'll move forward by a little step of time, and I'll record that down again. So instead of somehow storing the entire original wave, what I'm storing is just the amplitude of the wave at a particular time interval. So essentially, you can think of it as, instead of a line, I essentially have a list of points. Of course, since this is now a set of discretized samples, I can easily save all of these, right? Every position is just a number. I can, of course, reconstruct the wave by laying them out and connecting them together. So there you go. That is how we actually solve the problem of, you know, how do we actually save a continuous wave into a media that only stores discretized information. We basically just take samples, and that gives us a discretized representation of the continuous information. So that's great, right? We've solved everything. Well, not exactly, because the concept of sampling still gives us some issues. Now, before we continue, let's take a very quick detour to look at the concept of frequency. I'm going to be using this term quite a lot, so yeah, let's try to make sure we're on the same page with regard to its definition. What I have here is a sine wave. And essentially, in this sine wave, it's basically one segment that is repeated over and over and over again. The frequency of this wave refers to how many times this single segment repeats itself per second. So if I were to say a 440 Hz sine wave, then you'd basically imagine a wave that looks like this, repeated 440 times over per second. Of course, this does not just apply to a sine wave. Basically, almost all sound is essentially made up of one short segment that repeats over. So yeah, you can basically say almost any sound has a frequency. And, well, you can express it in hertz. So just a very quick summary of the concept of frequency. Let's now move on. Now, take for example this. We have a wave that looks like this, right? This is basically a sine wave and it is pretty high frequency. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to try and sample it. Don't forget that when we are performing sampling, the sampling interval, that is the distance between each one of these points, is arbitrarily determined by us. Of course, there are certain ways for us to decide, you know, what sampling rate we should use. And in fact, this is something I will cover in this particular video. So yeah, just hang on to that thought. Let's just take a look at this kind of contrived example. All right, so I have a sine wave. And now let's say I want to sample it at this particular interval. So taking samples, I get something that looks like this. Now, when I actually use these samples to reconstruct the wave, you notice a problem. The wave we get back looks nothing like the original wave that we've tried to sample. This is a problem called aliasing. And a simple way to describe this would be if I were to sample any signal at too low a sampling frequency, I'm unable to accurately represent that frequency, and I end up getting a lower frequency instead. While we've done this entire video in terms of sound, aliasing can happen anytime sampling is used. For example, image rendering. See how the checkerboard pattern over here appears to sort of merge together? Well, that's aliasing. So what we're gonna do now is we're gonna move on to the next important concept, and that is how do we avoid aliasing? Now, I'm gonna quite grossly oversimplify this concept, but hopefully I can still carry through, you know, the core meaning behind it. Essentially, the idea behind this theorem is if there is a maximum frequency that I want to hear, that is a maximum frequency that I don't want to, you know, get aliased and destroyed, this theorem tells us what sampling frequency we should use to guarantee that. The Nyquist theorem simply says this: the sampling rate should be double that of the maximum frequency you want to represent without aliasing. To be very exact, if your sampling rate is 2B, then all frequencies less than B will not be aliased. Notice how we cannot guarantee that for frequencies that are exactly half the sampling rate. Let's try and make this more clear with an example. Let's go back to the sine wave we've seen previously. And let's first try and see why there's a problem with sampling at exactly double the frequency. We begin by identifying one cycle of the wave. To sample at exactly double the frequency of this wave, we'll need to take two samples in this interval. Watch what happens when I try to do that. All the samples land at exactly zero, and we end up reproducing a signal that is entirely silent. And that's why I have to emphasize that for a sampling rate of 2B, you only get to keep frequencies less than B. What this means is, for this particular wave, we have to sample at a rate of slightly more than twice every cycle. So here's my attempt at very roughly doing that. As you can see, the samples are now capable of giving us a fair representation of the original signal. And there you go, that is the Nyquist theorem, and essentially that is how you work around the issue of aliasing when it comes to sampling a signal. Of course, you might hear these two terms that may be slightly confusing, so right before we end off, let us actually define these two terms so that, you know, when you see them in literature, you know what's going on. These two terms are Nyquist rate and Nyquist frequency. And, you know, they might sound a little bit similar, but they actually mean completely different things. Nyquist rate refers to the sampling rates you need to use to prevent aliasing, whereas Nyquist frequency refers to the maximum frequency you can represent given a particular sampling rate. The way I like to tell these two apart, because they can get quite confusing, is that Nyquist rate uses the same term as sampling rate, and therefore one is referring to the other. Hopefully this helps you in telling the two apart a little bit better. Anyway, that's basically all there is for this particular episode. I know it's run a little bit long, but hopefully this gives you a very clear idea of, you know, the whole concept of sampling and what can happen as a result of sampling, and that is the problem of aliasing. And finally, how do we actually fix this problem? By sampling at a correct rate. That's all there is for this particular episode. I hope you learned something today. But until next time, you're watching 0612 TV. Thank you very much for watching. If you liked this video, consider checking out the rest of my work on my channel. Alternatively, you may be interested in a playlist of my earlier work on computing and computer science topics. If you'd like to show me some monetary support, I am on Patreon. You can find a link to my campaign in the video description. Of course, you can simply like this video or leave a comment. I'll be sure to respond as soon as I can. To keep in touch with my future uploads, do subscribe to this channel. And for even more updates, check out the official Twitter account for this channel at 0612TV. Thank you for your support.